Good afternoon, everyone. Today, welcome to Sushi Study Chapter 5 on Bonding Singapore. My name is Mr. Go, and are you ready to start? Okay, let's go. So, Bonding Singapore, let's start with the overview. We are going through Singapore, who are we? Why is it important to manage ethnic diversity? And next, we'll be talking about challenges of a multi-ethnic society. And last but not least, we'll be talking about how ethnic diversity be managed. But in this case, we won't be going through that because this will be your project work. So we're going through the first three of them. For first, Singapore, who are we? Let's talk about Singapore. Singapore, as of June 2012, we have 5.312 million people. This includes people who are living in Singapore now. So if you take a look at Singapore, we are actually made of different races. We also made of different religion. And we are made of different nationality. Yes, we are many people from different nations living in Singapore right now. So if you take a look at the race, race actually talks about a person's physical appearance. We can talk about skin color. We can talk about the hair color, of course, not the dye one. And we can talk about the bone structure. That's one way to identify. Some people have bigger bone structure, some race. Yes, and that's one way of discovering which race they come from. But on the other hand, if you take a look, in Singapore, we have 74.17% who are Chinese, 13.34% Malays, and we have 9.19% Indian, and of course, the rest will be considered under others, so 3.29%. So you can see who is in majority and who are in minority. So before we go on, even though we talk about the Chinese race, it's actually quite complicated because Chinese race is made up of people from Chinese origin. And it could be from Hokkien, Teochews, Cantonese, Hakkas, Hainanese, Hokchias, Fuchu, Henghuas, and Shanghainese. You can realize that, well, our ancestors come from there. So if you come from any of the places, etc., you are most probably of Chinese origin. Then we have the Malays, they are from Malaysia or Indonesia origin, from Javanese, Boyanese, Bugis, example. And Indians, you are from India, Pakistani, Bangladeshi, and Sri Lanka origin. So you can be Tamils, you can be Malayanis, you can be Punjabis, you can be Bengalis, you can be Sinhalese. So they could be from a variety, well, of Indian, Pakistani, Bangladeshi, and Sri Lanka origin. So it's not restricted to a single area. And other ethnic groups, they could basically include any other groups other than Chinese, Malays, or Indians. They could be Eurasians, a mixture, Europeans, the Arabs, and Japanese, Koreans, examples. So we realize that Singapore is actually quite a potpourri of races. So we next, we go on to religion. Religion, according to 2010, and actually a set of beliefs held by a group of people. If you want to define it, that could be one of the many definitions for religion. And if you take a look, it's defined by beliefs, by your cultural system, how you grow up, and worldviews as well. Okay, next. In Singapore, we have 16.4, which are free thinkers, they have no religion. And 45.3%, they are Buddhists or slash Taoists, they are grouped together in this case. You have Islam, which is 14.3%. You have Hinduism, which is 5.2%. You have Christianity, which is 18.2%. And you have the others. We are not mentioned here. And next, nationality. Nationality basically talks about a season of a particular nation, and if you are born in Singapore, most probably you'll be a Singaporean. So nationality, let's look at this infograph. In season in Singapore, you have 3.27 million, while PRs you have 0.54 million, and these make up our resident population. Basically, they are people who live in Singapore. They are making up 3.81 million. And next, you have non-resident population, means they are basically moving in and out. They are non-resident, not for long term at least. 1.46 million. And out of the 1.46 million, this is... Okay, so for this case, we start from the majority in first. We start from work permit holders, which exclude foreign domestic workers, which is on the right side. And we make up 46%. These usually are your construction workers and those that you see on the streets. And S pass holders are basically people with qualifications. They have higher qualification, they belong to the 8%. And diploma holder, basically they have qualification but not as high as S pass holder. They are slightly lower. They carry employment pass holders. And you have the students, then you have obviously your students from primary school all the way to JC and universities. Then you have the dependent of Singaporeans, PR, work pass holder, basically their wives and kids. Then after that, you have the foreign domestic workers. We are usually your mates. So next, let's look at the origin of Singapore multi-ethnicity. Ethnicity refers to a person's culture. So it's related to your nationality as well. Refer to your ancestry, where you come from, your language, and your beliefs as well. It's closely related. Or at least, what we know is that Singapore was a British colony since 1819. And after that, people from different countries, they travel to Singapore as they offer them better opportunities and a better life. In the end, they made Singapore their home because they find it quite nice over here. But of all good things, there are always danger which related to a multi-ethnic country. If you take a look here, the idea of conflict could happen between people of different races and religions. And if you study in the previous chapter of Sri Lanka and Northern Ireland, you realize that just because people of different races and religions live together, it doesn't mean that you'll be peaceful. Okay? Conflicts do occur, and we'll look at the reason why. You take an example, in 1950, we had the Maria Hertzog riot. This is related to your religion. 1964, of course, is related to your racial riot. And these belong to the category of threats from internal forces. And for the GI suicide bombers, which actually targeted Yishun MRT station, they are actually considered threats from external forces, which are from outside Singapore. So the question here is that, will the poorly managed perceptions and this can it actually lead to misunderstanding between the people from different races and region, and will it lead to conflict that way? So the question is that if we know that because you didn't manage your perception well enough, it's time to manage it. So let's look at the importance and why is it important to manage ethnic diversity. If you manage it well enough, you have security and you have peace. You'll be able to manage people well and safe to live, work, and play in Singapore. Of course, with peace, you have economic progress. Foreign investors are actually attracted by the peace and security to invest and set up companies in Singapore. They won't be afraid that they'll lose their investment due to riots or strikes, you know. And you got economic progress. And moving on to the next stage. So, in Singapore, it's actually quite a boost to tourism industry. If you look at the picture, it's Singapore medicine at the bottom. We actually refer to our medical tourism, where people actually come to Singapore to receive medical treatment. Where Singapore medical industries can be considered one of the top in the world. Okay, so you can come to Singapore, have a treatment. There's quite a number of people coming here for LASIK surgery because Singapore is quite safe and the quality is one of the best in the region. So with that, move on to part 3. The challenges of a multi-ethnic society. Let's take a look at a few of challenges that Singapore faced while coming to the present age. When we look at that, we have to manage a perception of different racial group. We have to manage a perception of different religious group. And we have to manage threats from external forces. 3.1, managing perception of different racial groups. We take a look at a case study of 1964 racial riot. In 1960s, this is an era where Singapore is actually facing a strain in relationship between Singapore government, which is a state government, and federal Malaysia. This is an era where they are actually fighting for political dominance. One of the key differences where between the Malaysian federal government and Singapore state is that one practice communal policies while one practice non-communal policies. And communal policies refer to a certain group of people that are given special rights and privileges in a country. And in Malaysia, it refers to the Malays. For non-communal politics, it refers to everyone in the country is given equal rights and privileges. It means that in Singapore, everyone is equal. You are not given special privileges because you are born a certain race or religion. So in 1964, PAP participated in the federal election of Malaysia, where he managed to win only one seat. But the one seat that he won actually made the Malays in United Malays National Organization, UMNO, feel very threatened. In fact, UMNO decided to do something about it. If you take a look, it decided to organize anti-PAP campaign in Singapore. It highlighted the poverty of Malays in Singapore and aroused feelings of dissatisfaction among Singapore Malays towards PAP, and it portrayed PAP resettlement and redevelopment program as anti-Malay. Because at that point of time, Singapore is trying to redevelop the Kampong Glam area, is trying to move Malay families out of that area, so to develop the area, and it's perceived as an anti-Malay move, and is trying to discriminate against the Singapore Malays. So in July 1964, it's during the celebration of Muhammad's birthday, Prophet Muhammad's birthday, a clash between a Chinese policeman and a group of Malay participants turned into a full-blown race riot over the next few days and months, which is quite serious. You can see in the picture here. We are talking about a few thousands of them attacking each other. So based on eyewitness report, we take a look. So when the Muslims were marching and shouting, "God is great," some Chinese men disturbed the process by throwing water and bottles at the group. This incurred the Muslims' wrath, and some crude words were exchanged between them. If you see from this source, right, you can actually infer that perhaps, just perhaps, who do you think is the culprit here? If you have guessed that it's a Chinese man, most probably you're right based on this source alone. Okay, so, but what actually happened according to the police is that when a police officer requested for the marchers to actually stick to a particular route, and the police officer happened to be a Chinese, he was actually attacked. And this is according to a John Lecane, commissioner of the Singapore Police Force. At a point of time, he described that incident. He said instead of being obeyed, he was set upon by the group, and he, meaning the Chinese policeman. And thereafter, a series of disturbance occurred as more group become unruly, attack passersby and innocent bystanders. So you can see that a policeman was just doing his job. He was directing a traffic, and according to what the police commissioner, the culprit doesn't seem to be the policeman, not the Chinese. Maybe it could be the Malays as well. So in the end, what happened is that there was full-blown riot, and you have cars being burned, you have the policemen were sending out curfews, and you have policemen, we have the riot truck over there. So you can see that it's a pretty grim situation. Okay, so you realize that it's important to measure perception of different racial groups. Now we move on to the second one, which is managing perception of different religious groups. So we can take a look at back to 1950s where Maria Hertogh riots occurred. So what happened is this lady over here, this young lady, at that point of time, you can see different pictures, you can see her with, at the bottom picture you can see her with her husband actually. Let's take a look. So what happened is in the 1950s, the domestic battle of a custody of a young Dutch girl. This young Dutch girl was original with her Dutch parents, and she was separated from the parents. In fact, she was separated from her parents during World War II because the parents were actually captured. So just before they captured the parents, they managed to deliver the young Dutch girls to the Malay family with Che Amina and ask her to take care of her. So after that, when the Dutch parents are released, the mom, Adeline Hertogh, was actually concerned about the girl and she wanted her daughter back. But Che Amina was not willing to give her up, of course. So in the end, they start fighting for the young Dutch girl. So the legal system appeared to be ruled in the favor of Eurasians, it appeared to be, and Muslims feel that they are treated unfairly, and you add in a few media reports which doesn't help to solve the situation. Instead, it escalates tension between the both camps, and what you have is a potential time bomb. So what happened is that in between, while during the court proceeding, Maria Hertogh, her Malay name being Nadra, was married to a Malay teacher. as you can see in this case, and she was only 13 at the time. So if you're 13, it's actually legal under the Muslim law to marry, but under the Dutch law, that is not legal at all. Plus, the parent did not give consent. The Dutch parents didn't give consent. So while they were fighting the legal battles, Maria was actually put in the Christian convent, and the press actually entered the Christian convent and take many pictures which angered the Muslims. Okay, this increased the unhappiness of the Muslim community. In the end, the Muslim community feel that their welfare was not looked into and they are being discriminated, and riots happened. Okay, so the riots occurred between the Muslim and the Christian community. What happened is that during the final, just before the riot occurred, courts only spent only 5 minutes to decide who win the case. Basically, it just means that they did not pay much consideration. They rejected Che Amina's appeal, and straight away, a riot occurred. In the end, they have to resort to curfew to solve this problem. They put a 24-hour curfew and call in the British and Malayan troops to maintain peace. And let's take a look at this video.
A stone's throw away from the ever-changing skyline of modern, successful and peaceful Singapore stands the Supreme Court, a proud architectural legacy of the colonial period. But the Grand Lady of Justice has also seen its fair share of turmoil and injustice. And one particular episode that stands out happened 50 years ago. It was the day of the verdict on the Maria Hertog case. The crowd was poised to strike. And it did, with explosive violence, when the verdict was made known. Like a fire, the anger and violence fanned outwards, with Caucasians being the target. 2 days later, 18 people had lost their lives and 173 had been injured. A.R. Jumaboy, who was in his early 20s then, remembers that day well.
This call came from some friends of my father in a panic that their brother had been stabbed. He was very fair and looked like a Caucasian. I took my old ramshackle car and drove on to the street, Arab street, which was in a sorry state, and glasses and windows shattered, shops all shattered up. I suppose the people were very frightened. My friends, was brother Champak Lal, whose name is still up there on the street. This chap was bleeding, so we went to General Hospital. He's got, I think, a scar somewhere. If you ever get hold of him, I don't know whether he's still around.
The riots were the result of a court battle for custody of a young girl. Maria Hertog was separated from her Dutch parents during the Japanese occupation. She was raised a Muslim by a Malay couple. Her natural parents claimed custody after the war. Maria was put in a convent during the trial. Press reports of such high-handedness raised temperatures even further. The colonial authorities had failed to appreciate religious sensitivities. It was an extremely costly mistake.
When this verdict was announced, apart from the crowd over there, this place erupted, you know. So one of those passions aroused by religious frenzy, irrationalism. And I think for us, the lesson here, the cardinal lesson, is never to run roughshod over sensitivities, whether they are of race or religion, in our multiracial society.
Okay, so you can realize that this is actually quite important, and an extract from the broadcast from Muslim leader Maulana Muhammad Abdul Alim Siddiqui, he actually said that with the full force of the Quran, I say that whatever is going on the street is quite contrary to the teachings of Islam, with reference to the riots. And please, please, for God's sake, do not repeat such things. Have confidence in your leaders who are trying their level best to create a better atmosphere. So you can see that from a religious point of view, it's actually quite important. So we need to manage that. And the third one will be to manage threats from external forces. So we look at a case study of Jamiyah Islamiyah, or in short, JI. So it's actually part of the transnational terrorism, where it can be defined as acts of violence which are global in terms of aims, organization, and impacts. And if you look at transnational terrorism, they have a few topics that we actually studied before. First one is LTTE, which stands for the Liberation Tiger of Tamil Eelam. You have talked about Al-Qaeda, which actually are the main culprits behind the September 11 incidents. And you have Jamiyah Islamiyah. The person in the picture, you know him very well. His name is Mas Salama. So these terrorist groups, their aim is very simple. Is to use race and religion to create ill feelings, terror, make you feel scared among different ethnic groups. So, Jamiyah Islamiyah. So, they are actually a middle group active in several Southeast Asia countries. And their base are mainly in Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, and Singapore. So, in December, Singapore authorities arrested 13 JI members, and 8 of whom have been trained in Al-Qaeda camps in Afghanistan. And in December 2001, they actually planned to bomb US Embassy in Singapore, Israeli Embassy, Britain Diplomatic Building, and Australian Diplomatic Building in addition. So they planned to bomb all this, as well as US and Singapore defense target in Singapore itself, which is quite scary. But luckily, they are arrested. So since 2001, 34 JI members were arrested under Singapore ISA, Internal Security Act, for terrorist-related activities, such as fundraising, purchase of materials for bomb making. So if you take a look of here, his name is Mas Selamat. He actually escaped from custody and he was finally arrested after that.
Mas Selamat Kastari, codename MSK, one of the leaders of Jamaah Islamiyah, a notorious terrorist faction, has escaped from Singapore's high-security Whitley Road Detention Center. The biggest manhunt in Singapore's history fails to recapture him. It is well known that Mas Selamat has planned terror attacks on strategic targets in Singapore. And now, many fear that Mas Selamat is planning another attack. In Singapore, security forces continue to scour the island.
It never happened in Singapore that we have seen so many uniformed personnel in public places. We knew that this is not just a normal detainee being escaped.
But after an intense four-week manhunt, the Singapore authorities seem to be no closer to catching Mas Selamat. They strongly suspect that he is no longer in Singapore.
Mas Selamat have two options to escape, either to Malaysia, Johor, or to Indonesia.
In Malaysia, the police have been on high alert ever since the escape. They have a hunch that this notorious terrorist may now be on their side and launch an urgent investigation. Intelligence Officer Assistant Superintendent Mohammed is dispatched to Johor.
We activate all the sources, assets that we have to come back to us and to give us information. Any information, any small lead will do. But unfortunately, there was nothing that we had.
In the aftermath of Mas Selamat's shocking escape and the failure to track him down, authorities in Malaysia and Singapore must find out as much as they can about what led the fugitive to take the road to terrorism.
Okay, so you realize that he is actually on the escape after a while, because he escaped from the Whitney Detention Center actually through a window and through a toilet window. So these are the posters that you see after he has escaped. You can see them around Singapore of him shave and not shave. Well, this is a parody of him, different faces. Okay, and actually calling toilet break, because he actually escaped from the toilet, which is true. toilet break, make friends on the prison break. This video will show you how they are actually captured him.
Famed as a cunning escape artist, Asia's most wanted fugitive can't be left on the run for very much longer. Police prepare to move in. As the clock ticks down to action, tension is running high.
And that morning, early morning, we conducted a dua, a prayers, before moving in.
By 7 a.m., the police and the special forces are in place, waiting just outside the village.
I personally hope that this operation doesn't have any casualties. No one will be injured. No bullets will be fired.
Quietly, exercising maximum caution, the unit edges closer to Musalamit's hideout. It is essential not to alarm the fugitive jihadist. Mission leaders fear that he may detonate a suicide bomb.
These people are willing to die, whereas we are afraid to die. They only need one lucky chance. We must be lucky all the time. So we moved in at 7 a.m.
On the 1st of April 2009, the Special Forces Unit, disguised as civilians, moves in on Southeast Asia's most wanted man, Musalamit Kastari. The dramatic sequence of events that follows is captured on police video, which has never been shown on television before.
The moment that Special Forces members ran in, I still have the fear that anything may happen. And it happened so fast because the element of surprise is there.
The capture of Musalamit is all over in a few intense minutes.
They came out, the commander of the unit shouted at me, "Secure!"
And then, the police come face to face with the notorious terrorist for the first time. For the Malaysian police, the arrest of Musalamit Kastari without loss of life, 11 months after his escape, is a triumph and a relief.
I arrested him, handcuffed him, and read his rights, and he was keeping quiet, occasionally mentioning, "You know everything, sir, you know everything, sir." They're trained to be calm, and the standard answer is always the same. "You know everything, you don't have to ask me, you have done your homework."
The Royal Malaysian Police Special Forces search the house for other occupants and explosives. They find nothing.
So you realize from this that Masama was actually trained not to respond to the police questioning by saying that they are trained to be calm and say, "You know everything, sir." You realize that these are not your average criminals, actually. They're in fact well trained. So the question is now is that why do they actually target Singapore? Why do JI actually target Singapore? And the reasons why is that Singapore is a country with many foreign establishments. We are friends, Singaporeans. Singapore is friends with many different countries and foreign countries, especially US. And he has a firm anti-terrorism stance and is friendly to the West. By striking right at the heart of Singapore, he can actually show off to the rest of the world that Singapore can also be defeated. Very simply. So that's the reason why. And what happened after that is that the reaction of non-Muslim Singaporeans, and you can see that there's actually quite feedback from 3% after a recent ISA. Singapore must act to check the rise of mutual suspicion. You take a look. This is from a Chinese senior civil servant by not even sharing the leave, which is crazy. Next, this is from a Malay executive. He noticed that only Malay motorists are being pulled over. The friends feel that the police were actually targeting Malays because of heightened suspicion following the arrest. And the PM says there is actually a logical operational reason. They are looking for a Malay suspect, and hence they do not stop the motorists who are Chinese or Indians. And the third one is from a Malay grassroots leader. He says that the Malay resident used to take a walk in the morning in his sarong. He said after the arrest, some Chinese Singaporeans avoided him when he walked towards them wearing his sarong. He said nothing's wrong with his sarong. He said that I asked him if his that was even for Chinese who knew him. He replied that they treated him like before. It goes to show how important it is for racial and religious harmony. If you know each other personally, so no matter what they do, you know their character, you won't be mischarging them. Basically, this mixed reaction, you're positive, you're negative, shows that there's an urgent need to ensure that GIRS do not affect the social cohesion of Singapore. Okay, so the key message is that different racial and religious groups in Singapore must still continue to live and work harmoniously with one another. This will move us towards how do we manage ethnic diversity, which I shall stop here because this will be your project work. And for that, I'd like to thank you for your time, and thank you, and goodbye.